It's my pleasure to welcome someone who will kick off tonight's program, Janna Levin. She is a professor. She's the Claire Tau Professor of Physics and Astronomy from Barnard College at Columbia. And it is my pleasure to ask her to kick us off tonight. I will mention one thing. She's the author of an amazing book, which we sell in the shop here, How the Universe Got Its Spots. So if you like hearing from Janna, maybe you'll like her book too. Thank you, Janna.
This is exciting. We all just survived a plague, so that happened, and here we are. I'm very delighted to introduce David Spergel, who is and always has been a superstar of really the highest order. He is a renowned cosmologist and astrophysicist. David has contributed to measurements of the age, shape, and composition of the universe. So, you know, small things like that, irrelevant things like that. He has used some of the most successful astronomical instruments, including the influential WMAP satellite. And it's worth mentioning that David was part of the original team that defined the mission and also really worked on establishing how the spacecraft would be built. So that's very significant. And that spacecraft has mapped archaeological records of the light left over from the Big Bang. It really provides details of the entire history of the cosmos. It's a remarkable thing. And one of the most influential contributions that David has made, of his many influential contributions, is understanding how to decode that map and understand what it says to us about the history of the cosmos. Some of those papers on that subject are the most cited papers in the history of the subject. I would say among the recent papers, they are number one and number two in the entire field, so very impactful. He's also very sought out for his leadership and his scientific vision, and it's not always that common that the person with that kind of gravitas is also in a leadership role. He's influenced so many astronomical projects, including searches for exoplanets and upcoming searches to study the atmospheres of nearby exoplanets in the search for life, for sentient life out there in the universe to understand if we're alone, including a leadership role as well in the Simons Observatory, which is an upcoming observatory of great significance, dark matter searches and dark energy searches. Essentially, David's breadth and influence are pretty legendary. I would say that paired with his world-class intellect is this kind of improbably affable personality as well. And I don't know how many people here in the live audience know David personally, but he really is just a great guy, and he's very spontaneous and fun and creative. Everyone who works closely with him describes specifically that creativity. I can't tell you how many of his closest collaborators have said to me he is the most creative person I have ever worked with, and that is of huge significance in a scientific field. There's something that's always struck me as well about David, and that is this sort of high-spirited pleasure and joy he has when he's working. That's very contagious. He has this unbelievable sort of innate ability to go for a discovery, but it's always in this almost childlike, joyous way. I don't really hear him kind of opine with overwrought romanticism about the universe. It's always just having a great time and going for the discovery. He's worked on topics that are so esoteric and difficult, like cosmic streams, or whether the universe is infinite or finite, very esoteric topics. But really, he's always had his eye on the big picture, the big brush strokes. He always knows what's genuinely really important. He's just extremely open-minded. And I would say his savvy in recognizing where the next discovery is going to come is almost preternatural. I don't give long academic style introductions, which I know is kind of the norm at some of these things. I mean, I could cite his grades in middle school. Not that he's told me that, and move chronologically from there, but obviously he has an impressive academic record. He was an undergraduate at Princeton and was a visiting scholar at Oxford and went on to get a PhD at Harvard. And we all know that David has this long legacy, but I don't really believe that those are the things that define or that we need to cite to describe his intellectual heft. I think that has been proven in his research, which is really much more meaningful. He has won essentially every major prize in the field, beginning with the early years when people are searching for great new talent, things like the Sloan Fellowship and the MacArthur Prize. He goes on in his career to win the Breakthrough Prize in Theoretical Physics, the Gruber Prize with the WMAP team, the Shaw Astronomy Prize. There's about 12 other incredibly significant prizes that could be listed. And if none of these mean anything to you, I think it's fair to say that essentially David has earned very nearly every accolade awarded in our field. To my mind, one of his most exceptional qualities is that he absolutely recognizes without hesitation what is interesting and important. He comprehends in what I call big brush strokes what's worth pursuing, but also in small brush strokes, how to calculate, how to do the hard stuff, how to find the math, how to follow the chalk. And after 3 decades at Princeton, he is still professor emeritus after leaving Princeton to become the founding director of the Center for Computational Astrophysics at the Flatiron Institute. And as we were discussing tonight, he is in his 4th day as the new president of the Simons Foundation, which I have to say is unparalleled in science philanthropy. He has many glamorous appearances in top lists of what I call X and Y, you know, the top 10 of most influential scientists in time. I mean, for me, most importantly, which I would like David to put in his CV, is that he is one of my top 3 most influential astrophysicists in my life. And it is my great pleasure to introduce my friend, an inspiration, a creative spirit, and truly a force of nature, Professor David Spergel.
So thank you, Janna, for that very generous introduction. And I'll note that with that introduction, I still feel like I'm on the 4th day of a brand new job with all sorts of new responsibilities, enormous amounts to learn. And it's a bit like, starting college, when like all of a sudden the level just jumps up and there's all new things you need to know. Or those of you who've gone down the academic path, your first time teaching as an assistant professor, where like, you're expected to rise to this whole new level. And suddenly you need to know things about neuroscience and all sorts of things. And there's just so much to learn, it's really fun. So, but today I'm actually gonna step away from my new job, back to my old life, now my hobby, as a cosmologist, and talk about a couple things. What I want to do today is really talk about 3 elements of the story. First, I want to introduce cosmology. I want to give you all a sense of our current understanding of cosmology and how we think about the universe. Then I want to talk about the geometry of the universe, right? So what's its shape? And in general relativity, geometry is destiny. And we'll talk about what that means about the future of the universe. Then I want to talk about topology. And topology is a different subject from geometry. It's related, but it's different. It's like, so is the universe finite in space or infinite? And we'll talk about how we can use the microwave background to make measurements of the topology of the universe. So let me start with cosmology. In order to talk about cosmology, we have to start with special relativity and teach you all special relativity. The key idea in special relativity is light moves at a finite speed. It takes a few billionth of a second for light to get from me to people in the front row. So you see me not as I am now, but as I was a few billionth of a second ago. The further out you go, the further back in time. The sun takes light about 8 minutes to get from its surface to here. You see the sun as it was 8 minutes ago. There's a wonderful scene in The Martian, a movie I recommend if you haven't seen, in which they're communicating back and forth to Mars. And you sit there and you wait half an hour for the signal to get there and half an hour for the signal to get back because it's 30 light minutes away. Further out you go, the further back you look in time. So the nearest stars are a few light years away. We see them as they were a few years ago. The Andromeda galaxy is a million light years away. We see it as it was a million years ago. When we look out at the microwave background, the leftover heat from the Big Bang, the star of our story today, we see the microwave background as it was 13.8 billion years ago. We're looking out and we're seeing the universe's baby picture, because as we look out in space, we look back in time. So this is one of the wonder, you know, cosmology is not an experimental science, it is a historical science. We look out in space and we see our past, and we try to construct a coherent theory to understand how we got from our past to our present. Now, the advantage we have over our historian colleagues is the universe is much simpler than human beings and societies, and remarkably seems to be governed by very simple laws. And one of the key elements in our the story is we now need to move from special relativity. Everyone's good with special relativity, light moves at a finite speed. Great. Now it's time to learn general relativity. General relativity consists of two ideas, as Johnny Wheeler, my academic great-grandfather, taught. Matter tells space how to curve, and the curvature of space tells matter and light how to move. So once I tell you the sun is here, that curves space around it, light from a distant star gets deflected, and the star, instead of appearing at its, what we think of its true position here, it appears here. And this was first observed in 1919 at the with the solar eclipse. And here's the New York Times from 1919 saying, "Men of science more or less agog over results of eclipse observation." More or less agog. I don't know what this means. And here's just some fake news. Stars not where they seemed or calculated to be, but no one needs worry. They're exactly where Einstein said they should be. That was the whole point. We could do that. Einstein taught how to do the calculation, made the prediction, and was where it was supposed to be. So this is the key thing behind our theory, general relativity. So general relativity, when we apply it on the largest scales, much to Einstein's surprise when the work was developed by De Sitter and others, realized that our universe could not be static, that the universe either has to expand or contract. And it was work by Hubble and others that showed that the universe was expanding. Now I think this is the thing that most people struggle with conceptually. What is the universe expanding into? And the way I like to think about it is the universe is expanding into the future. So my way of visualizing this is to think of the universe, let's suppress one dimension, and let's just think of a two-dimensional universe. So you think about the universe as a surface of a plane with galaxies on it, or a surface of a sphere. And for now, let's think of the surface of a sphere. And each galaxy is painted on it, and this is what the sphere looked like, say, 5 billion years ago, and this is what the sphere looks like today, and that sphere is expanded into the future. And the distance between galaxies grow. Now we can run time backwards. And as we go back in time, that sphere a billion years earlier is denser, denser. The galaxies get closer and closer together, hotter and hotter. Eventually, we keep going back in time, the sphere collapses down to a point in time. But notice there's no special place on the sphere. The Big Bang, as it were, happens everywhere. It didn't happen at a place. It's not an explosion that took off somewhere. It's this collapsing sphere back to this moment that we call an initial singularity. And at this point here, see, our knowledge of physics breaks down. We do not know how to propagate our equations past this point. And what we probably need to get past here is some way of combining ideas in quantum mechanics and general relativity. Our current best attempt at doing that is called string theory. And despite having some of the brightest people I know having worked on this for 30 years, we still can't tell you, did the universe begin here? Is this the first moment in time? Or was there something before that? But for our story today, we don't have to go back quite this far. We'll go back to about here, about 380,000 years after the Big Bang, where the universe was filled with hot gas, and the cosmic background radiation, the leftover heat of the Big Bang, was interacting with the radiation. And that radiation then can propagate from then forward in time to now. And much of what we'll talk about today is based on our observations of the microwave background. And as Janna mentioned, one of the things I was involved with was a relatively small team of people, primarily at Goddard Space Flight Center in Princeton, who designed a satellite, which we named later after one of our colleagues, David Wilkinson, to study this leftover heat from the Big Bang. So what we did was we mapped the sky around us at microwave frequencies and produced a map. That looked like that. And this is a map of the sky around us. This map is taken at 22 gigahertz, at which there's a lot of emission from the galaxy. This bright red thing is our galaxy, the Milky Way. And this is, as a cosmologist, not what we're interested in. We're interested in this stuff. The analogy I like to make is that we're looking out our car window at a beautiful scene in the distance, and there's some smudge, some dirt on the window. And the galactic dust, which dominates at these wavelengths, is effectively the dirt on the window. And what we need to do is remove that and study the leftover heat that's out there. And we make our maps at multiple frequencies, and we combine these maps. There's our highest frequency. So we take this map, and here that you see the dust is at this higher frequency is less significant. This map represents exactly the sphere. We're just taking this and projecting it here. So this is the sky around us. And what we want to do is we work to remove the effects of the galaxy. We do that, and what we're left with is the universe's baby picture. So this map with the galaxy removed shows what the universe looked like 13.7 billion years ago. And you should think of it as a sphere around us, effectively of radius about 13.7 billion light years. And what you're seeing here are tiny variations in temperature of about a few parts in 100,000 of degrees. And these tiny variations in temperature reflect variations in the density of the universe from place to place. And it is these tiny variations that grow to form galaxies. And the pattern we see in variations is actually produced by pretty well understood physics. It's basically the physics of sound waves. I start with denser regions, and I'll create an experiment in this room that will show you the effects of having increased density in a region, and you'll see what happens. I created an overdense region that had more pressure, that created a sound wave. That sound wave moved out. And we'll see that each of these hot and cold spots are basically just patterns produced by sound waves in the early universe. And that's what we're seeing on the microwave sky. So what we want to do is study these patterns, figure out what we learn from them. To show you the dangers, though, you want us to study patterns carefully. First thing you find if you look carefully on this map the letters SH appear. And that, you know, first I thought that was maybe Saddam Hussein, then maybe Stephen Hawking. I had another theory that because of our inability to remove foreground effects, we were missing the letters IT. You know, it wasn't clear what this was telling us about the universe. I think it's mostly telling us about our ability to recognize patterns, and even when they're not there, and reminds us why we need to do statistics. And, you know, there probably are not letters writ on the microwave sky. What we want to do is take these maps and study what we can learn from them. And this map, which we made around 2003, represents our best knowledge then, but we've continued to improve our measurements. And, you know, this shows the progress from the first measurements by the COBE satellite in 1992 to our measurements in 2003 to higher resolution measurements by the European Space Agency's Planck satellite in 2013. And today, we're measuring this at much higher resolution. Here's the measurements from Planck. Here's measurements we're making from the ground today in Chile in an experiment that we built in the Atacama. And as Janna mentioned, I'm part of the Simons Observatory. And the plan there is to map most of the sky at even higher resolution and get even more detailed maps. And with that, we can continue to improve our understanding of the basic properties of the universe. And one of the things we want to do with these maps, turning to our next subject, is study the geometry of the universe. So what do we mean when we talk about geometry? We're talking about the curvature of space. And the one way I like to think about these different geometries is in our flat piece of paper, the math they taught me at age 10 works. The sum of the angle of triangles, sum of the angles is 180 degrees. But now let's go to a sphere. Let's draw a triangle on the sphere. And when I do that, you'll notice these angles are bigger. The sum of the angles aren't 180 anymore. And that's because I have a different geometry. This is non-Euclidean. And this is positively curved, right? And here, the angles are less than 180. This is our negatively curved space. And these are different possible geometries. Now, remember, general relativity told us that matter tells space how to curve. So the amount of matter determines the geometry. If I've got very high density of matter, space is positively curved. Very low density, it's negatively curved. Just right, one in which the kinetic energy and expansion exactly balances the gravitational energy, that is a total energy of zero for the whole universe, then it's flat geometry. And all of them are allowed, it just depends, you know. And in cosmology, geometry is destiny. If the universe is very dense, the expansion stops. Gravity is so strong, it turns around and collapses. And a universe that starts in the Big Bang ends in a hot, fiery Big Crunch. So that's our fate if the universe is high density. The universe is low density, gravity's too weak to stop expansion, and the universe's expansion continues forever and ever. The universe ends up emptier and emptier, colder and colder. This is actually Harlow Shapley who explained this at the Harvard Faculty Club to Robert Frost. Robert Frost then wrote a poem, "Some say the world will end in fire, others say in ice," talking about the two possible fates. Another way of looking at geometry is to look at the way circles behave and spheres behave. So in flat space, the circumference of a circle is 2 pi r. Circle gets bigger, radius gets bigger, the circles get bigger and bigger. Same thing, let's go to 3D. 3D flat space, the area of a sphere goes as 4 pi r squared. The bigger the sphere is, the bigger its radius, the more its surface area. And, you know, that we can observe its effects astronomically. If I look at the flux coming from the sun or from a supernova, as I move further away from the orbit of Venus to the orbit of Earth to the orbit of Mars, the area of a sphere around the sun whose radius is Venus's orbit is smaller than Earth and even smaller than Venus, than Mars out here. So the flux I see falls off with distance. The flux is just luminosity over area. So if I can measure the flux of objects as a function of distance, that's another way of probing geometry. And why might it be different? Well, now let's go to the sphere. Let's look at circles on a sphere. If you're right near the North Pole, you walk around the North Pole, the circumference is close to 2 pi r. It's not quite, but it's close. Circumference gets bigger and bigger until you reach the equator, and that's as big as it gets. And now, if you move a further distance from the North Pole, so your radius is bigger, your circumference starts getting smaller and smaller and smaller. And in fact, the circumference drops off now as a sine. So it actually eventually drops to zero. It's minimum. And this works not only for my circles on my two-dimensional positively curved space, but if I look at spheres in a positively curved three space, the surface area of the spheres drop off. And that means if I'm looking at the luminosity from a star or a supernova or a galaxy, the way it behaves with distance is different in a positively curved or negatively curved universe. So that's one of the ways we can measure the size of the universe. But an easier way, actually, is to look at the microwave background and look at the size of these hot and cold spots. And the spots are going to be smaller in our open or negatively curved universe and bigger in our positively curved universe. And that's because nature is basically holding up a ruler to us. We know how big those hot and cold spots are. They're the distance a sound wave can move in the 380,000 years it took for the universe to cool and be able to form neutral hydrogen. So we know how that distance is. So nature holds up a ruler to us, and all we have to do is measure the angle subtended by the typical hot and cold spot. If that angle is a degree, the universe is close to flat. If it's less than a degree, it's negatively curved. More than a degree, it's positively curved. So what we were able to do was go back to these observations of the microwave background and just ask what's the characteristic size of each hot and cold spot. One way of doing the analysis, I think the most visually satisfying, is you can go to each hot spot and stack the map in regions around it and do the same with every cold spot. And here's one of the more recent analyses done with this, where here we stack on hot spots, here we stack on cold spots, and you can see there's a ring around the typical cold spot. That ring is a frozen version of that sound wave. That's how far out a sound wave can go in 380,000 years. And by measuring the angle subtended by that ring, that lets us measure the geometry of the universe. But we've got this rate, you know, this is the data. This is the fit to the data. This is the same around hotspots. This is with the pattern of polarization. And you can see our model fits the data remarkably well. From this, we're able to extract the basic parameters of our cosmology. We can learn that the geometry of the universe is consistent with flat. All I could say is consistent with flat. Remember that flat corresponds to measuring zero total energy, or zero curvature. And right now it's in curvature units compared. It's about 0 ± 0.01 is our current best measurements. And that's very close to flat, but there's always a possibility as our data improves, the universe is very slightly positively curved or very slightly negatively curved. You know, it may be that it's just like we're living in the middle of Nebraska. We can see out 10 miles, and on the 10-mile time scale, Nebraska looks flat. But if we could see further, maybe it's positively curved, or maybe it's negatively curved. We don't know. We just know as far as we can observe, and we now can do this with much higher precision than we ever have been able to in the past, the universe is consistent with flat. We could also take this data and, for example, look at the relative strength of the cold spots produced by dark matter and this hot ring produced primarily by radiation and protons and electrons, and that gives us a measurement of the density of atoms compared to the density of matter. And the thickness of this ring actually gives us a measure of the density of atoms. So from this data, we can actually infer really the basic properties of the universe. We infer the five basic numbers, the density of atoms, the density of matter, the universe's age, its lumpiness, and how that lumpiness varies with scale by looking at those patterns. And we've measured the age of the universe to be between about 13.7 and 13.8 billion years. And if you've ever watched the show The Big Bang Theory and that song, that's where the number comes from. And they've got one of our beach balls if you watch it. So now we've measured the geometry of the universe. So the next question I want to turn to is the topology of the universe. Is the universe spatially finite or spatially infinite? And to do that, I need to talk about a bit about topology. So let's start with a flat 2D square. So that's locally flat. And I'm going to identify this side with this side. So I roll it up to a cylinder. Then I identify this side with this side. And I get a donut, or since this is New York, it's a bagel. And this is a compact universe. If I keep going in this direction, I come back to where I started. If I keep going in this direction, I come back to where I started. So that's a finite universe. Equivalently, I can use this in this representation here, since these two sides are glued to each other. If I exit here, I come back here. If I exit here, I come back here. And some of you may have played video games that have that property. You exit one side, you come back the other. So that's this is a two torus. Or, and Janna gets to hear this story twice, when our colleague Neil Cornish was a postdoc at Cambridge working with Stephen Hawking, he was finishing up a paper he started with me at Princeton on looking for the properties of these donut-shaped universes. And when the creators of The Simpsons were doing an episode with Stephen Hawking, they talked to Neil. And Neil described his work, and they were very excited and incorporated this into the Simpson episode immediately. And there's a Simpsons episode in which Homer Simpson presents to Stephen Hawking his donut model of the universe. So I feel one of my greatest intellectual accomplishments is to have my work represented as if it was done by Homer Simpson. Down here is another way of representing the topology. This, you can think of this donut or two torus and this square with identified sides as two ways of telling the same story. A third way is a tiling, where I take identical copies and I cover all of space with identical copies. And those are equivalent ways of thinking about it, and we're going to want to make use of this one in a moment when we get to three dimensions to see what's going on. Well, I've talked about 2D tilings of squares. I can also look at tilings of negatively curved spaces, tilings of positively curved spaces. But now let's go to three dimensions. So here's our three torques. So now instead of identifying two sides, we'll identify this yellow side with this one, this red side with the back side, and this blue side with the bottom. So if I exit here, I come back here. And this three torus, I can also represent it with this tiling, where there are identical tiles glued together. And this Earth is the same as this Earth, and this Earth, and this Earth. They're all the same copies of each other. So if I'm a spaceship traveling here, I appear in all of them, and I just continuously move from one to another. And this is a useful representation for our purposes, and we'll come back to it, because when we look at the microwave background, the leftover heat from the Big Bang, that's a sphere around us. So you can think about observing a sphere around here, and a sphere around here, and a sphere around here, and you'll notice the spheres intersect at circles. And that's going to be our key signature for topology. And just this, you know, we talk about the torus because I think that's the easiest one to think about, but they're actually an incredibly rich set of possible topologies. In negatively curved space, there's actually an infinite number of topologically distinct ways of tiling. And they, there's also tilings for spherical space. Here's a tiling that works with regular dodecahedrons in negatively curved space. There's just lots of fun ways to do this. So for me as a physicist, one of the things I really enjoyed when I got into this, I had never studied topology at all as an undergrad or as a graduate student, was just learning this and thinking about what it means in cosmology. And, you know, throughout my career, I've always enjoyed getting to learn something new. And this was, you know, a couple decades ago, 20, but it was great to move into this new area. And now let's go back to our microwave background. Remember, it's a sphere around us. We have multiple copies of ourselves. Two spheres always intersect a circle. That's generic. It's easiest to see with our three torus, but that's also true for our other tilings, is when you have multiple spheres, they're going to intersect at circles. Those circles actually tell me, if I could detect them, what the underlying geometry is. So there's what will happen with one of the simulated models. You have all of these identified circles when the different copies of the universe overlap. What does that mean if that was a description of our observed universe? Is I would draw one circle here and another circle here, and I'd have the same pattern of hot spot, cold spot going around this way as I do this way. And I can look for all possible circles. There are a lot of possible ways of drawing circles of different sizes. So what we need to do is you're not going to do this by hand. You're going to write a computer program. You're going to simulate this. And this is a simulation showing what we would see if the universe was finite. We would find, and this is how good a match you get as a function of angle. And, you know, the matches are not 100% because there's some other things that contribute besides that surface. But the dominant, you know, the matches are, could be quite good. And this is as a function of size of the circle, the quality of match we find. And this picture actually corresponds to the image I showed before, where you look for really good match circles. Now, if you randomly do things, you find matches sometimes. It's like finding those letters SH. Sometimes you just find something. So you have to work hard to simulate what would happen randomly. As an aside, well, ask me about Roger Penrose's cosmology work and what happens if you don't do simulations. this is what happens randomly. You have some random signal you expect to see. And, I think I'll tell the story this time again. So one of my most exciting evenings, nights, was running this code for the first time. So at the time I was doing this analysis, I was doing this on the side while I was doing the full analysis of the basic models. And I was part of a very small team, leading a very small team of about four people responsible for all the analysis for the satellite. I was doing this while I had a three-month-old and two other kids under the age of seven. I was also acting department chair because the mission had been delayed for a year, and I had gotten a sabbatical this year before the mission was launched, which wasn't bad because I used the time to learn optics and wrote a paper on exoplanets that worked out okay. But I had put everything off to the year when the data came. That's when all my teaching and administrative stuff and the baby was there. The good thing for getting your work done about having a two-month-old is they wake you up every 3 hours, so you have time to look at computer programs and chess. So I was up looking at the codes, and I was just checking it and running it. I was like, now the data, I'll run it. I saw exactly this match. It was a perfect match. And at this point, I couldn't go to sleep. And I'm testing this, and I had discovered the universe was finite. And finally, about 4 or 5 hours, 5 in the morning, I fall asleep. I send an email to my colleague, Gary Hinshaw, who was working at Goddard. I describe what we found. Gary then said, start to understand, would look at it. He asked me in the morning, which for me I think was now 11 when I finally woke up, what versions of the data did I use? He wanted to check, but you have different versions. What I had done is I had written code to generate these simulated maps, these simulated skies. I had outputted them, it was late at night, with I think a file called map.dat. That overwrote the other file with the real data called map.dat. And I managed to do a double blind test on myself where I overwrote the real data with the simulated data and discovered what was in the simulations. But it was very exciting to think that I had discovered a finite universe. And then I ran the real data, and that's what I saw. And this is what you expect by random. This was what you expect as the best match possible, given that they're random fluctuations in a typical map. Yeah, there's one of those. This is exactly what you expect to see if there's no evidence for topology, no evidence for finite universe. So data improves. This is measurement from the European Planck satellite. They repeat the test. Here's their simulations. The Europeans have a team of 400 people on their papers. They're not paper author list. They're not up late at night. It's a French-led project. They're working 30 hours a week. They're saner than we are. So they don't reproduce. As far as I know, they never faked themselves out. They got better results, improved results with higher resolution data. They have slightly better constraints. And the basic conclusion you come from all of this is, fundamentally, the universe is big. That we can't prove whether the universe is infinite. All we can show is that it's bigger than a certain scale. And that scale's roughly as far out as we can see. The universe is about 13.7 billion years old. That's about how far out we can see. That sets the scale of what we call the fundamental domain, effectively how big is that cube that we live in. And it must be at least that big. It could be much bigger, it could be infinite. All I can tell you is we haven't seen signs that the universe is finite. Okay, so what should you take away from this? First of all, it's a pretty exciting time to be a cosmologist. We've been able to measure the basic properties of the universe. We know its age, we know its composition. We actually have this simple model that, as you saw, fits all our data. Same model also fits the large-scale structure of the universe, its expansion rate, and all the pieces hold together. So on one hand, we have a very successful model. On the other hand, deep mysteries exist. Atoms, the stuff that make up us, makes up only about 5% of the universe. The next 25% is in dark matter. The rest is in dark energy, energy associated with empty space. We don't know what dark matter is. We don't know what dark energy is. All I can tell you with confidence is it requires brand new physics beyond the standard model. It requires something new. We don't know why there's more protons than antiprotons. That also requires brand new physics. And we don't really understand, well, the physics that generate these fluctuations. We have ideas, but they need to be expanded on. All of these things require physics beyond the standard model. So I think one of the takeaways, particularly for the students in the audience, is there are tremendous deep problems to solve. We don't know what most of the universe is made of, and solving these problems will point to new physics. So I think it's a time of tremendous opportunity. Also want you to get a sense of really the deep connections between the way we think about mathematics and physics. That, you know, we can talk about concepts like geometry and then talk about the geometry of the universe. And we see that the geometry of the universe is close to flat, which means that the future is open, it expands forever. We don't know whether the universe is finite or infinite, but we can talk about measuring and constraining its topology and say it's very big. And to me, when I look at all these fields, all these things, the really remarkable thing about the universe is its simplicity and its elegance and the fact that the kind of mathematics that really, you know, geometry and that lies behind general relativity describes the universe on its largest scales. And when I think about this stuff, I always think about this wonderful article by Eugene Wigner on the unreasonable effectiveness of mathematics. That it, to me, is remarkable that we have the language, the way of thinking, that seems to be able to describe much of the properties of our visible universe. So I'll leave you with that and take some questions. Thanks.
All right, I see a hand over here, so we'll start with the live audience in New York.
Just an intuitive question. The negative model and the crunch, they have sort of a long-term behavior that you can imagine. What does it mean to be open?
Open means open to the future, that it expands forever. It's a universe that ends up cold. So I simplified things a bit by saying geometry entirely determines destiny. That would be true if the universe was filled by matter. Because of the presence of dark energy that causes the universe to expand more rapidly, even our current universe, which is flat, so it's zero energy, expansion wins, because the dark energy becomes more and more important and drives expansion. Now there's, some of it in the end might depend on the properties of dark energy. If this, the things we don't know. Will the dark energy persist forever? If it decayed into matter in the distant future, and the density of the universe was slightly positive, it could, which is consistent, the universe still could contract in a Big Bang, but it's not much, Big Crunch is not much parameter space that allows the universe to collapse in a Big Crunch of the dark, based on the current data and our current understanding. So it looks like a cold, empty future.
Hi. Thank you very much. This is very interesting. Question I have, if you can define what does it mean shape, for something to have a shape implies it has boundaries. So boundaries in something bigger, so by universe we not mean everything everywhere?
Well, shape, in this case, we mean two things. Geometry is local curvature. So is it curved, positively curved, like a sphere? Is it negatively curved? So that's what I mean by, one thing I mean by geometry. Something can be negatively curved or flat and infinite. A flat piece of paper, well, flat piece of paper. Imagine, take a piece of paper and extend it to infinity in all directions. An infinite plane is flat everywhere, but it doesn't have a boundary. It goes on forever. I can have a surface that looks like a hyperbola, that is our hyperbolic surface, that's going to be negatively curved, go on forever. So I can have a shape, but not have a boundary. Now, if I have a finite topology, to say you're finite, means that it doesn't mean you have an edge, but it means if you keep going, you come back to where you start. So think of that donut. If you live on the surface of a donut, you can keep going forever, and you'll keep coming back to where you started. Now, when we think of the donut as a two-dimensional object, the surface, in a three-dimensional space, in that three-dimensional space, it has a boundary, because you have your donut, your bagel. But if I think about it as a tiling of an infinite space where I keep going through copies, I don't really think about it, at least I don't think about it as a boundary or an edge. There's no part of it that behaves like an edge. There's no, it's like if you have a sphere, every place on the sphere, ignoring the fact that this isn't a little inflation thing, imagine it's a uniform sphere, every point on the sphere is equally special. That's my modern way, because everyone's special. I don't want to say no place is special. Every place is special on the sphere. So that there isn't a boundary point on the sphere, right? On the sphere surface, every point is equal. Yes?
I wonder if part of the question is that it looks like a boundary in the sense of an embedding.
Yes.
Not so much an edge.
Yeah, it's not an edge. It's not, this is a two-dimensional surface, the edge, in a three-dimensional space. And that's just one way of, this is one way of representing it, the sphere, and it's just, to me, the important thing about the sphere is the fact that what happens when I draw the triangles, it's a local.
All right, so people online, feel free to ask questions in chat and I'll see if I can get to them. But there was a lively dialogue a little earlier. Can the universe be finite if it's continually expanding? Yes. If the universe is infinite, then how does it expand? The expansion is slowing down because you can't add to infinity? So I think it's the question
okay.
of, yeah.
So, the universe could be finite. We could be living on the surface of, I think it's easiest to visualize it 2D. We could be living on the surface of a donut, and that's a finite universe, and that donut just keeps getting bigger and bigger with time, and the size of the donut grows. And that's something that's finite in space, but ever growing and expanding to the future.
It's, I guess, the same question. Can you explain sort of the correspondence between finiteness and finite lifespan? The universe is only finitely old. I think that's a source of confusion. How could it be infinite because it started with the Big Bang and it hasn't gotten far?
Well, we don't know how it started. Well, we don't know whether the universe started with the Big Bang. There's really two possibilities. Either it started with the Big Bang or it didn't. If it didn't start with the Big Bang, it actually could be infinite into the past. And there's some nice work by my former Princeton colleague, Paul Steinhardt, on models that undergo bounces and re-expansion. Most cosmologists usually consider models in which time started with the Big Bang, but we don't know whether, and that Big Bang happened everywhere at the same time, but we don't know at that moment, was the volume of the universe already infinite? Was it infinite universe to start with that just keeps expanding, or was it a finite universe? Personally, I like the universe being finite. I just have it easier to think about, perhaps finite and large. But that's my own personal prejudice. We have no observational evidence for that. You know, if it was up to me, which it's not, I would go for a finite, a negatively curved compact universe, because there's so many cool things about topology and negatively curved universes that would be my choice. But, you know, no one asked me.
All right, here's a question from chat. In the event of a cosmic big crunch, I presume what is being crunched is not merely matter per se, but all of space-time.
That's right.
Thus, it certainly seems plausible that all of our physics rules would be rewritten again, similar to how they came into existence with the Big Bang originally. Consequently, all bets are off for future Big Bangs, yes?
So this question of what happens when the universe collapses to initial singularity is one of the great open questions in physics. So I think of 20th century physics as having a couple really amazing ideas. Among them are quantum mechanics, which works incredibly well to describe the small, and general relativity, which works incredibly well to describe the structure of space. Right? And, you know, we've recently had these wonderful measurements detecting gravitational waves from black hole collisions that are showing that general relativity, this 100-year-old theory, is working beautifully for describing space-time. Quantum mechanics works beautifully for describing atomic particles. Yet we try to talk about what's happening at the enormous densities and temperatures that would happen near the big crunch, even before we get to the crunch itself, but just as we approach it, requires combining quantum mechanics and general relativity. And we don't know how to do that. String theory represents our most active attempt to do that. Many of the brightest people I know in physics have spent much of the last 30 years thinking about string theory. They've learned a lot, but they still can't tell me what happens dynamically at a big crunch. We need, you know, so it's really a point at which our knowledge of physics breaks down, and we need to learn more physics. We need to answer the question of what's happening in the big crunch, what's happening, is there before a Big Bang? It really is our understanding breaking down, which is why we can't give you a solid answer to this question. You know, as we go back in time and the universe gets hotter and hotter, you know, the stuff I'm talking about, the universe 380,000 years after the Big Bang, the temperature's 3,000 degrees. You can go to any laboratory and get stuff up to temperatures of 3,000 degrees. That's not that much hotter. You know, your oven goes up to 500 degrees, right? We know the physics of atoms at 3,000 degrees. We've done that. We've been doing those experiments for 100 years. You go to the LHC, you can get to higher and higher temperatures. The temperatures you need to be able to probe where ideas from quantum mechanics and general relativity come into interaction, temperatures that scales we call the Planck temperature, those are so enormous, it's well beyond what anything we could ever do experimentally. Well beyond our experiments. So our work there is really guided basically by mathematical elegance. And we look at theories we have, and we look at their structures, and we hope to find something that works. Now, mathematical elegance has often worked, and we've had some real successes. But lots of times it really requires experiment to push you towards the right physical model. So it's this is what fundamental physicists do, is they struggle with how to answer these questions. And we're still working on it.
All right, we're going to finish up with a couple of questions online, this is one person asking two questions. The first one's a doozy. I have more hope for the second. Why did the universe start expanding in the first place? And why didn't gravity keep it as a singularity?
That's an easy one. We don't know. It's a good question. In some ways, we're asking these questions, get to questions, I would say, of initial conditions. How did the universe start? And we're actually not that good at having theories of initial conditions. We're much better at having theories of, I would call, dynamics. Once you've started something, what happens next? So we're getting to, with some of these questions, which makes them really interesting, the limits of our knowledge.
Thank you all very much, and let's give a big hand to our presenter.